Good morning, Professor Chan, Professor Chen, Professor Fan, lab mates, my family who will watch this video and will need some translation. To my beloved one and friends, welcome to my master thesis presentation. My name is Mario Wata, and the title of my thesis work is The Effects of Varying the Surface Roughness on Copper Tubes in Full Volume of Water. When I first joined to this laboratory, I knew Professor Chen was conducting experiments in heat transfer two-phase flow. I learned from my seniors how to conduct experiments in full boiling, and I was really excited by the idea of the mechanism behind of full boiling. So today, after 2 years of doing so many trials and errors, here I'm presenting my thesis work. So let's start. The outline of this presentation is in the classical way, the introduction, some brief literature review, and I will end giving some recommendations and the future directions of this thesis work. What is boiling? Boiling occurs in the solid-liquid interface. When the also, it is characterized when the surface temperature is higher than the temperature of the working fluid. It's also an effective heat transfer method. The boiling, the pool boiling, exhibits no bulk fluid flow, the liquid is dormant or static, and the motion is due to natural convection and buoyancy. Let's have a look at this figure, which describes what I have just said in an illustrative way. When the heating element heats up the test piece, as we increase the heat flux, bubbles start condensing and will start rising from its surface. Some of the industrial applications that we might see for the heat transfer two-phase flows, they are the power plants, electronic devices, the aeronautics or aerospace industry, and cooling systems. To better understand what is pool boiling, we need to understand the pool boiling curve. In this case, this is the pool boiling curve of water atmospheric pressure. This graph, the y-axis is the heat flux, and the x-axis is the wall superheat. The wall superheat is the difference of the surface temperature with the working fluid. Let's see at the first stage. The pool boiling curve is divided in four regions. The first region is the natural convection boiling. So we might not see bubbles at this stage because it's in the convecting region, but boilers will start appearing just before reaching the onset of complete boiling, as seen in this figure. When we move on to the second region, which is nuclear boiling, bubbles start condensing, and then we will reach to the inflection point. After this inflection point, bubbles will start rising. We will reach the critical heat flux, which is the maximum heat flux given in the system, and then after this point, the system will dramatically drop the heat flux while the wall superheat is increasing. At this point, we get to the latent frost point, and then the wall superheat and the heat flux will dramatically increase. For the literature review, I will show some of the techniques that in the last decade pool boiling has been classified. These three techniques are the passive techniques, the active techniques, and the combination techniques. The passive techniques are really economical to produce. They are also easy to manufacture and prepare, and there is no external power supply required. The passive techniques can be achieved via surface roughness modification, by cutting the materials that will be tested, or by microchannel fabrication. Let's have a look at the active techniques. Professor Wang from the MIT carried out an interesting experiment by controlling the bubbles by giving really small voltage inputs to the system. These are gold plates, and they were really capable to control this. The working fluid was modified with a charged surfactant, and by doing this approach, they were able to lower the wall superheat of this system. The combination techniques are the combination, the benefits, the good things of the passive techniques and the active techniques. Let's have a look at this work done by Professor Yo. he conducted experiments in full body using flat copper plates, and they coated them with hydrophoric surfaces. These surfaces had a different surface roughness. While they were increasing the roughness in the hydrophobic coatings, they saw that these surfaces exhibited lower wall superheat at the same heat flux inputs. However, they were only good at the low heat flux. These surfaces that exhibited low heat wall superheat, they reached their critical heat flux earlier, what is expected of hydrophobic surfaces. Professor Stelud, he conducted experiments in cylindrical tubes, but instead of water, they used some refrigerants, R123 and R134A. They used three types of materials. They used copper, brass, and stainless steel. While brass was the best one, copper was some of the middle results, which they said like is the standard material, and the stainless steel, which showed the worst performance. They also mentioned that by increasing the roughness of these materials, the heat transfer coefficient is also improved. However, they emphasize that there is a limit of the range of the surface roughness. While we have really high heat surface roughness, we might not expect a good heat transfer coefficient. Professor Gary Mella from Purdue University, he also conducted experiments in full body. But interestingly, they use superhydrophobic surfaces. Before, nobody has attained how to reach these superhydrophobic surfaces to the nucleic boiling. But they emphasize that the gassing process is really crucial and important while doing so. We can see in the results that the green line, which is a sample without any coating, just plain copper as a reference, the red line, which is the superhydrophobic surface in the Kessig-Baxter state. And in the Wenzel state, this surface exhibited the lowest wall superheat and the best heat transfer coefficient performance. Professor Chen and his group of researchers, they conducted the effects of the size of the pattern. After testing different sizes, they found out that the 2 millimeters by 2 millimeters square pattern exhibited the best performance. And this is due to the intercoalescence of bubbles that occur inside of the patterns. And lastly, in the literature review, we have the work done by Professor Kanikar, which they modified copper cylinders and they have fabricated microchannels. They mentioned that by the red line, the black dotted triangle line curve here is a cylinder in plain without any modification, just plain copper. But by increasing and modifying the size, the dimensions of the width and depth of the microchannels, they observe that the wall superheat is decreased at the same heat flux inputs. They also mentioned that the effect of when placing the copper cylinder in the horizontal or vertical orientation didn't have much differences. They saw a plain copper tube, it had a quite relatively similar encasement, which at the horizontal orientation was up to 2.6 and in the vertical orientation up to 2.1. So after doing many literature review and the experiments done in this thesis work, I can address the following objectives for this work. The main objective was to study the roughness effects by varying the surface and the roughness of these cylindrical pieces. I took the roughest sample and also I did some cutting with hydrophobic patterns and also to understand the behavior of the bubbles. The bubble formation. I wanted to evaluate and I evaluated the circumferential surface temperature along all the cylinder. I recorded the bubble dynamics by high-speed imaging. And lastly, all this was done by a new and redesigned experimental apparatus. Let's have a look how was this done, how their devices were connected we can see here the experimental setup, the main components. We see the copper cylinder at the center and folding by two peak materials. All these components is the computer, the logger, reflux condenser. We have here to control the auxiliary heater and to preserve the working fluids at saturated temperature, and the DC power supply, which will control the cartridge heater or the main heater inside of the test sample. This is another overview of the experimental setup and the assembly. The test piece was only 2 centimeters width by 23 millimeters diameter. I used 10 thermocouples. 8 thermocouples incrusted in the experimental sample and 2 thermocouples to average the temperature of the working fluid. This is a deeper overview of how the experimental tube was held by these peak holders, and silicone rings were used for avoiding leaking. This is the method I use how to encrust the thermocouples, 4 thermocouples located at the center of the cylinder and another 4 at more near to the edge. This is the area for the experimental works. With the computer I could control and see the real temperature reading, and also I could capture the high speed imaging. The fabrication process was done by, first we will polish the test pieces, we will rinse them with acetone, we will blow them to have a more clean sample. They will be sonicated for 10 minutes to remove impurities or some grease, and they will be heated. After this plain copper was prepared, I will treat it with UV light. In the case that the sample with hydrophobic patterns, I will follow the same steps. I will print the patterns, I will heat it up again to dry out the patterns, and I also will apply UV light. At the end, I will check if all these pieces are all right, and then I will use them for my experiments. This is an interesting and a good technique to make uniform scratches on the cylinder. I will rotate about 1,300 RPM these cylinders, and I will apply the corresponding sandpaper ring number. These are the 3 samples with different, you can observe different scratches. This is due to the different sandpaper grain number and produce different roughness on the samples. The sample number 4, I use the roughest. I use the sandpaper of 150 number to produce the roughest surface. And all this printing technique was done by, I prepared polymer mixture with these chemicals and these amounts. I will use a screen printing device. This screen printing device has an extension mesh with the patterns I want to print out on the cylinder, and with care I will prepare these samples. Of course, it was necessary to evaluate the surface profile of these samples. I conducted the 2D and 3D profile analysis and the profile for the roughness, and checking the roughness of my samples were really smooth and uniform. For the static contact angles, to avoid the complexity of the curved surfaces, I use plain copper plates. And I printed some hydrophobic lines, and I could test with the genometer and see that by increasing the roughness, the static contact angle will increase, which roughness alters the wearability of the surface. The hydrophobic pattern exhibited the highest static contact angle. And this is the results of the surface roughness and wearability results We can see here the four samples used. By increasing the roughness, we can see that the static contact angles also increase. For the case of sample number four, this is the roughness of the hydrophobic region exceeding the highest static contact angle. And of course, was also good to evaluate the dynamic contact angle of these pieces.
What's RC?
RC is another parameter of the roughness mainly in the commonly used in the industry RA for, and RC is another parameter to have a more overview of the complete roughness of the samples.
Right, so what's the relation with between RA and RC?
The relation is the way how it's calculated. RA sometimes cannot give a complete overview of the roughness, while RC might give a deeper understanding of RC. However, in the industry, sometimes they will mainly just ask about RA because it's the common and the
so
basic.
Can you give the formula how to calculate?
All right.
Explain.
Yeah.
What's the formula to calculate RD?
For the case of the RA, there are some peak and valleys that will be calculated from the roughness. However, sometimes RA limited to know the width. The RA cannot sometimes know if a scratch was uniform or of the width, and RC can give an overview and the average how the width and depth are calculated. So in the industry, sometimes they might not only ask for one value, they might ask for RA, RC, RQ, and some other hybrid parameters.
So you mean the RD is the width, right?
Yes, also RC, for the case RC also will consider some width. However, for RA, we'll consider just depth and valleys. In this case, I wanted to include RC to give a more complete
Can you make a plot?
Yeah.
What is RA, what is RD? Make a plot.
Okay, yes, I can do it. For the case of the RA, for example, we have a roughness profile in this way.
Okay. See?
So for the RA, there are some peak and valleys calculated, and this RA will average these values, these areas.
Okay.
And it might give us some number. But for the case of RC, for the RC, give us a different profile, because RC also will consider the width of these profiles, which RA is limited by just giving these peak and values. The peak and value. But for the case of RC, also will take into consideration the width of these spaces.
Okay. So that means so what's the formula for the RD? It's equal to the width, or equal to the width square plus I square. I square and then take the square. Can you give the formula for the RD? How to calculate the RD?
Right now I don't have explicitly in my head the exact formula for RC, but what I know is we consider the width.
Yeah, please give the clear explanation in the thesis.
Okay.
How the RD is calculated.
Yeah. Alright. Okay, thank you very much for the comment. Mm-hmm. In the data regression, I simplify this understanding by some illustration. We can see QR, which is the relative heat. We have QL, which is the heat loss in the actual directions. QT, which is the total heat input given from the cartridge heater, controlled by DC power supply, and we control the voltage. Delta X is the difference of the depths of the thermocouples. TS, which is the surface temperature at the outer part of the cylinder. TM, which I average before thermocouples located at the center of the of this test piece. So after many tests and analyzing all this data, I plotted here the experimental data of the four test copper tubes. Let's have a look at this in this folding curve. Well, this is the heat flux and low superheat graph. Test number one, which is the reference, was the smoothest sample. And by increasing the roughness of these samples, we can see that we can lower the wall superheat. At the same time, the heat transfer coefficient, we can see some encasement. However, for the sample number four, which had the roughest surface with hydrophobic products, exhibited the best results, providing the lowest wall superheat and highest heat transfer coefficient. But this is good at the low heat flux region, because with hydrophobic patterns, we reach critical heat flux earlier. But in the case for the plain copper tubes, we were not able to reach critical heat flux because it's higher. And another reason is because the limitation of our cartridge heater, we cannot go beyond higher amounts of heat flux. Another interesting case analyzed was the circumferential surface temperature difference of these copper tubes. Let's have a look at the case number one, when only four thermocouples are evaluated, two thermocouples at the upper section and two thermocouples at the lower section. We can see some trending here in case number one and two. Between the heat flux of 50 to 100 kilowatts meter squared, we observe the highest heat surface temperature difference. But while we apply more heat flux, this difference starts becoming steady. However, these four locations were limited because we were not evaluating the temperature effect of the edges. While we do a complete overview of all the cylinder, we can see a more complete analysis of this circumferential temperature evaluation. We can see the highest temperature difference, which the sample number four shows the lowest difference. And as we increase the heat flux, the difference remains almost the same. The upper section and the lower section, they have quite similar temperature along all the cylinder. This is good because we want a good evaluation and good temperature distribution along the cylinder. The reason why it is cause these results is because the hydrophobic patterns help to distribute in a more uniform manner the bubbles, and therefore the temperature was distributed in a more uniform way. The high-speed imaging is presented in this graph and was divided in four intervals. For the four intervals, we have sample number one and two, sample number four. Let's have a look at the interval number, first interval. This is when the convecting body occurs. We might not see bubbles. The bubbles present here were formed on the rings, but they will be gone after we increase the heat flux. In the interval number two, we can see a slightly higher heat flux, and bubbles will start, the departure diameter of the bubbles will start increasing as we increase the roughness of the samples. For the case of interval number three and four, it's difficult to observe the bubble dynamics, but we can see that in a following video, in following slide, I will show the video of this. But for the case of sample number four, around between 400 to 450 kilowatts meter squared, it's when it reached its critical heat flux. And we observe this film boiling like bubble on top of the surface. This prevents the heat dissipates into the liquid, because this bubble like film boiling like bubble will work as an insulation, and it will dramatically rise the wall superheat of the of this sample. Please have a look at this video. This is for the smoothest sample. Some evident nucleation sites can be observed and low heat fluxes. When we move on to the next sample, which we increase slightly the heat flux, we can see more nucleation sites and the departure frequency is higher. And when we move on to the rougher surface, which is plane, frequency keeps increasing and increasing, and the temperature of these bubbles is also bigger. And we can observe the sample with the hydrophobic patterns, which distributes the bubbles in a more uniform way. And we can see here when this sample reaches its critical heat flux, and we can see these thin boiling light bubbles. I prepared some illustration about the bubble dynamics in the low and moderate heat flux regions. We can observe here a copper tube undergoing a heat flux of about 400 kilowatts meter squared. At the beginning, no bubbles are observed, but we start seeing the small bubbles at the bottom of these test pieces. At moderate heat fluxes, bubbles start rolling in a parallel way up to towards the upper section of the cylinder, as we can observe in this video. These are the overall results of the four samples. We can see here the four samples, which they had different roughness, as taking sample number one as the reference, sample number two exceeded a slightly better heat transfer encasement ratio, but the best one was by the sample with hydrophobic patterns, which exhibited the lowest loss of heat at this given heat flux capacity. The conclusions of this work are: the roughness changes the wearability behavior, which as we increase the roughness of the sample of the surface, we increase the static contact angles. The roughest surface evaluated in this work exhibited a lower also per heat and a good heat transfer performance. However, the best performance was shown with the heterogeneous sample, exceeding the lowest also per heat in case HTC by a factor of 1.5 compared to a plain copper. Bubbles were distributed in a more uniform way, and the lowest circumferential temperature difference. These experimental apparatus show that can endure high heat fluxes for future evaluation if we want to try and find a way how to conduct experiments in higher heat fluxes. Of course, there are some recommendations that I would like to address here. The test pieces need to carefully and in a meticulous way be prepared. The way how they are polished, not to put them for long periods of time in the oven, because we want to avoid the thick oxidation layers on its surface. The heater needs to properly or carefully correctly be placed, because the heater has some non-heating areas, as we can see in this picture. I put them outside because those areas are not heated. So we want a uniform distribution of the heat toward the test piece. The DC power supply, a higher heat fluxes, needs to be carefully operated. It is important to record the room temperature of each time you do your experiments, to have better repeatability of all your experiments. By using the stencil screen printing, depending what is the concentration of your polymer, the viscosity of your polymer will change. You need to choose an appropriate mesh count. At the beginning, I could not make possible that the ink will go through these small holes because of the high viscosity of this polymer. As I choose these dots with lower mesh counts, the polymer can go through it. And the future directions and future work of this work is, one possible ways is use different working fluids. There might be charged surfactants, we might use seawater. Seawater might make some corrosion in the system, we can check that, or your salt water. We can test different materials. Besides copper, we can check the performance of brass, steel, and aluminum. And also, we might check and use a compound technique. We can use the approach of roughening the surface by applying an electric field. I was lucky to work in this laboratory with my seniors to get the experience of co-author some publications, and one publication which is under review, and this thesis work which was published and which is under review for possible publication in the International Journal of Heat and Mass Transfer. Of course, I would like to acknowledge today the presence of the committee members, Professor Chen, who has from day first always provided me his guidance and support day by day, and lab members who always encourage me in my work. The lab staff, without them, is really valuable their support. The staff from Mechanical Engineering Department, the workshop worked really hard to fit in our test pieces. This company who expedited the fabrication of the materials. To this institution to give me the privilege to be here, to MOFA to provide me a scholarship to come to Taiwan and study my master program, and most for fundings for projects in our laboratory. Last but not least, to my family, my beloved, and friends. And thank you. This is the conclusion of my presentation.
I would like to address several questions to Mario.
All right, Professor Chang.
I read your thesis. I see the study present the positive techniques. It includes the surface roughness modification. This use the cover tube with the hexagon patterns, but I'm not sure why you use the hexagon, the pattern.
Not use the shape.
Use a circle or a square.
That's a really good question, Professor. One of my seniors, he studied the size effect and also the shape of the patterns. They tested triangular shapes, they tested circular shapes, and they also tested square shapes. Among all of them, the square shapes and 2 millimeter size exhibited the best performance because the way how the bubbles are generated. The reason I choose the hexagonal shapes is because I firstly evaluated different size. I tested circular and also square, and I saw that the hexagonal shapes were showing slightly better performance than the square patterns that were in the previously published by one of the seniors.
Okay. Another question is Professor Pan and your advisor. This how do you account for difference between the mean roughness and the mean roughness dip? In your thesis, I think you write this down very clearly. Oh. I am wondering if you would like to elaborate on this point in your thesis.
Yes, you mean to answer about Arcida?
I think you maybe to write clearly to comfort the difference between the mean roughness and the mean roughness.
All right, thank you for the comment. I will address.
So, yeah, write down the clear formula for mean roughness and the mean roughness steps.
Yeah, right.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the comment.
And I see your thesis in the chapter 4, the results and the discussion in the page. On the page 38, you write through the surface roughness variation and use the lithography techniques to print the hydrophobic patterns.
Yes.
I'm not sure this process in this work is the lithography process. If yes, I think the study should be clearly written for definition of this process.
So pitch.
I think the annual process to make the patent is to use screen printing done.
Yes, that's true.
But that's not the lithography process. But, and if you are using the lithography process, you need to have the photo mask, and you need to have the chemical etching, something like that. But you don't have those process, so probably you cannot use the lithography process. You can only use the screen printing process.
Yes, that's right. I use the screen printing because besides just studying this roughness and effect in my cylinders, I wanted to investigate what happens to a rough surface when it's modified with available equipment in our laboratory by doing the roughness effect.
But you say here the lithography technique. You cannot use the term lithography. Page 38.
Ah, lithography, yes.
Yeah, lithography. Yeah. When you mention the lithography, that means you do have the photo mask, and you do have some like the exposure. After the exposure, then you are apply the chemical etching to etch out the photo resistance. Yeah. You can only say you are using the screen printing process.
All right. Yeah. Thank you for the observation. When I did some research, I found out that some people was addressing lithography when they were just using the stencil mesh, but it seems that I need to be more specific in that point.
On the other hand, I think that your thesis have already submitted the journal. So I have this one question. Based on the title of thesis, I wonder why you emphasize is on the HTC rather than CHF. I'm wondering why you would compare surface roughness which with CHF on copper tube in a pool tube.
All right, yes, I can.
In a pool boiling.
Yes, Professor. The reason that I don't emphasize and I don't talk much about the critical heat flux is because due to the limitations of our experimental setup, we cannot reach the critical heat flux on these copper tubes. So we cannot be sure about what happens if we go beyond. Actually, from previous setup, we increased by 3 times the capacity of the heat flux, but we still cannot investigate the heat critical heat flux on copper tubes. There is really few literature carried out in copper tubes, so that's why I wanted to do pool boiling in copper in cylindrical tubes. We can see plenty of literature reviewed on flat plates, but the complexity to generate high heat fluxes by only using one heater, that's one limitation. And for this reason, I made some correlation, and my approach of my discussion was between to see the roughness effect and to see how the HTC was affected.
The question is, we don't do the critical heat flux. The only one is cathode flux, that can be done. But we think that they do it very dangerous. Maybe the sound is more than its different aspect. Because the heat is in the middle, the area is very big. 不像我从下面加热可以做很小的面积，那我这边觉得做的这个都往中间小面积。我现在有一个 ceiling 的，我就不懂那个为什么那个 cuticus 那个还可以做到 critical heat flux， 圆柱就是够了。除非你中间那个平整那个 power 大，可是因为我早已做圆柱，就是这么大，除非我这个圆柱是不同的材料。
它可以把那个热量就直往一边跑，所以你的material跟roughness那个非常的这个复杂性。它的当然可以问它的什么时候到多少，那我们要
polish 就是这个地方可能，what's the surface roughness for your smooth cube?
For the smooth tubes, I can show here, it's 0.032 micrometers. This is a mirror-like roughness when it's already...
Even 0,
Yes, I can go to that slide.
The roughness is.
I have the results here.
You have the table.
Yes, yeah, this one.
Okay. So it's about 30 nanometer.
Yes, that's right. This is from previous senior roughness considered as a smooth. This is in the range of that. And as well for the plink, Polish literature reviews when they say plink tube or a smooth tube that is within this range, which they consider as a smooth surface.
These two cases, but you have the contact angles which are quite different from the other two. What's the reason?
Oh yes, for this sample number four, what I'm showing here are the results of the hydrophobic region. Here in this caption, I noted that the roughness of this sample number four was same as sample number three. However, I modified this sample number three with hydrophobic patterns, which had this roughness value. And by this roughness value and the properties of hydrophobic materials, they exhibit this high static contact angle. Both hydrophobic materials, they have different advancing contact angles. And therefore, the hysteresis is lower than plain copper tubes.
Okay, so you mean that for case four, you have hydrophobic material?
Yes.
So the other three are not?
Yeah, the other three are not.
So that comes to my another question. One of your main purposes is to study the roughness.
Yes,
right. That is different from what people have done in their studies. Is that right? The effect of roughness is the one of your main goals here.
Yes, that's right.
So here you want to study the roughness using normal material, but do you also use the different materials like these hydrophobic materials? So you can also study the roughness using the same materials, hydrophobic materials.
For the case of if I want to use different materials, then I should focus on the roughness effect of this material.
Yeah.
In my case, I wanted to study the effect on plain copper tubes, and by providing the same roughness to sample number four, which was an extra sample, we can compare what happens if we modify you, even if you go further, besides just having the roughness on the modifying the roughness of our sample and the addition of hydrophobic patterns.
So, regarding the plain material, so you have three cases.
Yes.
Have you plotted the convergence of these contact angles, such as the hysteresis, to prove that the case one is already approaching the smooth case? You mean, you know what I mean? That is, if you have different roughnesses, but you don't know which one would approach the smooth case, so that you can treat that as a standard case, as a smooth one. Then you, of course, you will go below the even the finest one you can reach. How do you choose that kind of standard smooth case?
That's a really good comment, Professor. When I was doing my literature review and my experiments, I wanted to know what is considered a smooth surface out there for the researchers. But till today, I couldn't exactly find explicitly that someone would say, okay, this range is a smooth surface. Sometimes they provide some comments or in their work saying this is a mirror line. It's really smooth, but there is no standard range which we might say, oh, this is a smooth So what I notice is that many people will consider previous publications and say, oh, my sample is in the close range of these researchers, and then we can consider our sample as a smooth.
Yeah. So that's why I ask this. So maybe you don't have really perfectly smooth case, but at least when this roughness is smaller than certain value, it approaches some its level off. Some characteristics are leveled off, like your critical heat transfer or your heat transfer enhancement. So if that means if you use, for example, your case one or two, actually they have similar performance already.
Yes, that's true.
And if you use case three or even with a rougher surface, actually relative to the case one, case two, of course, its performance is worse. So then you can claim that, okay, when the roughness is over, is as small as a case two and case one, then it's already similar to, it's already level off. So you don't have any more benefit if you go to smaller roughness.
Yeah, that's right. For that comment, then I should have consider and don't different pieces, not just rely on three pieces and maybe probably 10 pieces. For that case, I saw that by slightly increasing the roughness, we were seeing already observing better HPC. But in the literature review, they mentioned that even if we go beyond higher numbers of roughness, the HPC probably, they observed and they plotted that it doesn't show a good heat transfer coefficient engagement. So there is some range, but there is no standard that we have, like for example, many things that standards, like ISO, but for the roughness, we cannot see some interval, that a specific interval that researchers can rely and say, okay, we might investigate the roughness or we might take our sample just within this range. Before, the samples were published by hand, so it was difficult to control a uniform scratches on directional scratches on the surface. And by investigating the surface profile by a profilometer, we can see that the roughness values of our samples are really smooth, really uniform. This small peak is just a small crunch. It was present from originally in the sample, which we can observe in the confocal, which is this small peak.
Yeah. Then, okay, regarding my other questions, in your conclusions, the first conclusions, you talk about the roughness. And its relation with the contact angle,
yes,
especially hysteresis. And you mentioned that the sample pool has lower contact angle hysteresis because they have higher receding and advancing contact angles.
That's only hydrophobic region.
Only for that
yes,
material.
Yes, that's right.
So, okay, so it doesn't apply to the other three cases.
Yes, that was for, if I just provided the characteristics of the plain samples, we couldn't know what was the surface profile of the hydrophobic region, so that's why I provided those details of the hydrophobic region.
Yeah, because I was confused about your claim here, because it's still, contact angle hysteresis is somehow not really directly related to the advancing and receding contact angles. They could be separate, right? Even they could have you could have large advancing contact angle and a small receding or large receding, then the hysteresis would be different.
Yeah, like the case for the plain samples, we can see, as you mentioned, in high advancing contact angles and low receiving contact angles.
Yeah, but these two groups are actually not related to each other. You cannot use case 4 to compare directly to case 1, 2, 3, because they are made by different materials.
Yes, that's right.
That's why I try to make good. Because you put it here. I'm quite confused somehow about why you have such a big difference in the advanced receiving and then hysteresis. And then you make your first conclusion based on this four, this case four. But actually, that is not your main conclusion, is it?
The main conclusion is that by using a simple, let's taking account, let's forget simple 1 and 2. When I'm taking account simple number 3,
yeah,
he had the lowest ball superheat and best performance between just plain copper tubes. But what happens if we add the hydrophobic patterns on this simple using some in simple?
Yeah, I think the better presentation should be that. Yeah, so you have table 1, you have only used 3 samples,
right.
1, 2, 3. Yeah, so you are completed the surface roughness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because right now all the receding angle and the bouncing angle and the hysteresis all are the same.
Yeah.
But the table 2, you can only compare the sample 3 and the sample 4.
Right.
Yeah, because right now, yeah, you do have the same surface roughness for the copper, for the copper surface. And both surface roughness are the same, 0.544.
Yes.
But for the sample 4, you print the hexagonal hydrophobic pattern on the copper surface. So if you put the dynamic angle over here, you should put say that's only for the copper, and you still say 0.101018. Hysteresis is 998. Then you put the hydrophobic surface over here. Say, but here there's no hydrophobic surface. So you just put the number over here. That will be for the hydrophobic patterns.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Don't put together. Yeah, and it will lead to some misunderstanding.
It will be easier for people to understand what you are trying to say about this table. It could be quite meaningful. But if you put them some relevant information together, then somehow it could be confusing.
Okay. Thank you.
So right now, so you are only compare the effect of the surface roughness on the pool boiling, and also with the same surface roughness at RA equals to 0.544 micrometers, and you do some experiment to find out if you do have the heterogeneous wettability, and then what happened for the heterogeneous wettability, the effect of the heterogeneous wettability on the pool boiling at the same surface roughness. So that's the two main points you wanted to express. Yeah.
All right. I will separate these points.
Yes.
Thank you.
So you may consider somehow modifying your conclusions, writings, just to point out what's your most valuable findings?
Yes, Professor.
And another comment is that you consider to make your figure better looking, like for example, your chapter 4. Your chapter 4, you see, for the figures 26, you see, on the printout, we can even not see what the font is.
Oh, yes.
You have such a big space, but you don't use it efficiently. So I don't know why you cannot just make it bigger so that people can
make the figure bigger. Yeah. Don't set the paper. Don't need to set paper.
The font is too small. Maybe my eyes is not so okay, so the last one I want to ask is the...
You mean like this,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Yeah, somehow like this.
Like separate them,
yes.
Make it bigger.
Yeah, make it bigger, yeah.
Like this, the font size.
Yes.
Okay, but now it's already large, but we can see from here. But if you look at your thesis, somehow it's not easy to see the contrast.
I knew that one problem of that will come. When I had some issue in the printing area, and they printed out twice, but they didn't refer to my latest version, which I modified. Because after printing, I saw, oh, this is too small. And I didn't require to go in three times of printing. And thank you for the comment. And I already addressed the issue, at least for the fingers.
Okay. Yeah. And the last one, I was just wondering, why do you put surfactant in your future direction? Of course, that may not be what you are going to do later. Maybe your junior, your subsidiaries. But in your future directions, you mentioned the surfactant, because if you use ionic or anionic surfactants, they would be quite different regarding these properties, especially considering this absorption, desorption properties close to the interfaces. That could cause substantial complexity when you do this. But of course, that could be something if you consider some electronic effects to see how they migrate around the interfaces and to see how they could achieve that heat transfer enhancement. That could be another topic that I didn't listen carefully what you say about that point.
Yes, about that point is when I presented about the active technique, and one group of researchers uses surfactant and they added some electric field, I want to see. The reason I want to see this surfactant effect is because if I add an electric field, then we can absorb and dissolve the bubbles, because it will attract to the surface and they will absorb them. And then when we give different voltage input, they will dissolve them. In this order, we can control the bubble dynamic on the surface, as how it was presented in the. And we can see what happens when we combine a passive technique like roughening, because we have not seen a literature work in such a way, combining this roughening, passive technique of by roughness and applying electric field. This is similar to the active technique I presented at the introduction. So that's the main reason that adding the surfactant will be really beneficial if we want to add an electric field in the system.
Why can you have interaction between that surfactant and electric field?
The surfactant and its charge, right?
Yes, because the charge
to the surfactant.
Yes, because surfactant might be positive or negative, ionic or anionic. And by applying this electric field into the test piece, we might control this behavior on the copper tube. But really limited work have been done on copper cylinders, so this might be one direction for future works.
Yeah, but it is not easy to insert, separate the heater and a separator. Region for a circular cylinder.
That's right.
It is not easy to make it. Probably you need to have some kind of ring shape heater for doing that. And again, at the beginning, Mario wanted to do wanted to investigate this topic. Yeah, but finally he gave up. Yeah, it is too difficult. Yeah.
No, was because the reason was because at the moment I wanted to do this, we didn't have any setup for the electric field in our system. I designed the setup for a possible future work for applying electric field, but there are some equipment required for that, and that's why I just tried the surfactant without an electric field, but the results were catastrophic. There were some bubbles coming out.
That's what I said. If if you have surfactant itself, it's very complicated. You have to consider its tails, and it's it could form this if you have too much, of course they will collapse. But if you just have a little bit, maybe it could be okay. So at the beginning, you see some difference. You could see some difference.
That's right. Probably at low concentrations.
Yeah, but probably with his PhD thesis.
So he's going to.
Yeah.